So in this talk, I will discuss almost very basic things. For some of you, maybe it's really very basic, but some of you which are not familiar with this kind of stuff can maybe I will just give a brief background and some results I will declare, I will announce, and maybe you could, in the meantime, you can go through those results. There will be some exercises you can do on your own, and you really enjoy this topic. So after this historical development, I will say something about the Euclidean geometry and then two models of hyperbolic geometry, Poincaré disk model and upper half model, and some of their I will talk about the group of isometries of the two models. And then what are the basic motivations for further investigation, that I will say something about that. So basically, I will be emphasis that most of our natural surfaces have a natural structure. Most of, I'm not saying all the surfaces, but most of the complex surfaces, they have a natural structure of hyperbolic manifold. So that I will say in my last slide. So as you know, this geometry is one of the classical discipline of mathematics, and it's basically started from the measurement of Earth. And Euclid is responsible for the systematic study to formulating five axioms. And out of those five axioms, four axioms seems to be very trivial, but the fifth is really very complicated, and the fifth axiom is actually responsible for the much part of the geometry. So what are the five axioms? In very short, I will just say. So suppose this is actually, it's not the version of Euclid, it's a, in some sense you can say it's a modern version of the five postulate, so a set theoretic version. So let X be a set, and L and C with the sets of certain subsets of X. We call elements of X as points, elements of L as lines, and elements of C as circles. Then this the set of the collection of these three set, the set of lines and set of circle, if they satisfy the following condition, we'll say that it satisfies the Euclidean five postulates. So the first postulate is that if the two points are given in the set, there exists a unique line passing through the two points. It's very simple, as you see in your Euclidean high school geometry, that if two points are given, there exists a unique line. And any line segment joining two points can be indefinitely extended in either direction. So this is also a very simple axiom, as you can feel in your Euclidean plane geometry. The third axiom is, so given a point and some distance is given to you, you can draw a unique circle with center at the given point and radius as your given distance. Or in other term, you can say that if two points are given, there is a unique circle with center at one point and passing through a second point. Fourth postulate is all right angles are congruent to each other. And these four postulates are it's so simple that actually they don't need any clarification for even high school students. But the fifth one is little bit involved, and it says that if a line is given and a point P which does not lie on the line, then there is unique line M which passing through the point P and does not intersect the given line L, right? So this is called the parallel postulate of the Euclid. And this parallel postulate is actually, it's controversial. Several people says that it actually it can be derived from the rest four postulates, and there were lot of discussion for more than two millennia. And in the meantime, this René Descartes established the concept of an analytical geometry. So in early 17th century, he actually, so the problems of geometry, you can correlate with the problems of algebra, like say a straight line in Euclidean geometry, you can have some correspondence with a system of linear equations and so on. But finally, this in 19th century, these three mathematicians are responsible to say something about the fifth postulates concretely, that this fifth postulates you cannot derive from the rest four postulates, but if you little bit change this fifth postulate, there is equally established geometry. So this is the new kind of geometry you can see if you just modify the fifth postulate. And these geometries are basically hyperbolic geometry and elliptic geometry. So basically, this Lobachevsky, Bolyai, and Gauss, they are responsible for the development of this new thing in the Euclid postulate, and therefore the establishment of, you can say, this new geometry started here. So mainly in this, as the name of the talk is Introduction to Hyperbolic Geometry, so now I'll be say something briefly about the hyperbolic geometry only. I'm not go in detail to this second one, that is spherical, but just say one slide about this spherical geometry. So in spherical geometry, what is the change in the fifth postulate? So for instance, here your set is the surface of a sphere, and the set of all great circles. So here you see there is no straight line, as the straight line in the plane, there is no straight line. But for us, the straight lines are actually the great circles. Great circles means circles having same center as the center of the sphere. So we have the set as the surface S2, and this capital L, all great circles of S2. So you can see, so take any great circle. Maybe you take your great circle as this horizontal circle, and you take any point, say B, which does not lie on this great circle. So now the question is, can you draw a great circle passing through B, which does not intersect this horizontal circle? So answer here is no, you cannot draw. In fact, there is no concept of parallel lines here. All lines intersect each other. So in this spherical geometry, there is no parallel lines. All lines will intersect each other. So the next geometry, what is called hyperbolic geometry. So I will present here two models of hyperbolic geometry, where you can see that through the point which not lie on the given line, there are in fact infinite many lines which passing through the point and which will not intersect the given line. So here the first model is what is called upper half plane model. So here your set is, suppose we identify with the set of complex numbers your R2, and you take the upper half part, right? So the collection of all complex number Z with imaginary part of Z is positive, or if you write in your Cartesian coordinate system, the collection of all XY with Y positive. And this L, so we call them L, right? So for the moment, let us assume that these are lines for us, but we'll prove it in fact. So what are the lines? So here actually the lines are all vertical lines. All vertical lines are line for us, and all semicircles centered on this horizontal line. All semicircles centered on the horizontal lines are lines for us, and also all vertical lines are line for us. So this A is the collection of all straight lines parallel to y-axis, and the set B is the semicircle centered on x-axis and lies in H2. Right? So you can see here, if you take any line, so maybe you take this line as your line, and you take any point here, say this point is your point, and you can see there are a lot of circles, at least three lines you can see here, which passing through this point and which does not intersect this line. In fact, there are infinite many lines you can draw through the given point which will not intersect the given line, right? So if you assume these are our lines for this space, they form a equally established geometry, and we call it as hyperbolic geometry. Another model of this hyperbolic geometry is this, what is called Poincaré disk model. In this Poincaré disk model, your set is this unit disk, open unit disk, the collection of all complex number with modulus less than one, strictly less than one. And for us, the lines are either straight lines passing through center, straight lines passing through center of this disk, or all circles which intersect the boundary circle orthogonally. So here we consider line as all usual lines passing through the center of the disk and all circles which intersect this boundary circle orthogonally, they are line for us, right? So just like in this upper half plane, you can also see here that if you take any line means either a line passing through center or a semicircle which intersect boundary circle orthogonally, and you take any point which does not lie on that line, you can draw infinite many lines which will not intersect the given line. So here also the parallel postulate violates, right? So up to this level, because some students are also there, so if any query or any problem, feel free to ask.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Basically, here we are considering lines. So,
yeah.
What are the geodesics are considered as the lines in these spaces, right?
Yeah. Basically, they are geodesics. They are geodesics for us. I told you lines, but they are basically geodesics for this. I have not defined geodesic yet, but yeah, you are right. These are actually geodesics for that particular space, right?
Exactly. So
yeah,
that is
yeah.
Why we are considering it lines. In RN, the geodesics are straight lines. So
yeah,
the
yeah.
Geodesics is named as lines here.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so next I will say something about the Euclidean geometry, and then we'll come back on this hyperbolic part. So in Euclidean geometry, so what we do, so suppose V is your n-dimensional vector space over R, and this D,
sir,
is the distance function. Yeah?
Sir, can it be in full screen? Full screen.
Yeah. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So let V be n-dimensional vector space and with some inner product, right? The standard inner product. And we define this D as the distance function, right? Then this pair, this V with D, this is called n-dimensional Euclidean space, right? And the line element in this En is given via this formula. This ds square is dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dxn square. And with the help of this line element, you can find the length of a curve. So suppose gamma t be a curve in your Euclidean space. This xi t means this x1 t, x2 t, xn t. And you can find out the length of that curve as the integral of speed of the curve, right? So integral of speed of the curve is the, you can determine the arc length of the curve in Euclidean space, right? Now, a bijective map F from En to En is said to be an isometry if for each xy, it's preserved the distance, right? So we have defined the distance as this distance. So if this distance is preserved, we say this bijective map as an isometry of Euclidean space. And I'm not going to prove it, but you know, it is completely classified. So a bijective map from En to En is an isometry if and only if it's an orthogonal map followed by a translation, right? So this tau A, so in fact you can see from here that this translation is an isometry, because whenever you translate, the distance between two points will not change. Even when you rotate, the distance between two points, you can see at least in E2, in the case of n is equal to 2, if you just rotate about origin, the distance between two points is not going to be changed. Even if you reflect in a line, the distance between any two points is not going to be changed. And in fact, in dimension 2, these are the all isometries, so with their compositions, right? So in fact, in higher dimension, in dimension n, it is completely classified, and any isometry is actually the composition of an orthogonal linear transformation composed with this translation, right? So that is this f is given by this rho x plus a, right, where rho is an orthogonal linear transformation and A is an element of Rn, right? So this is responsible for, you can say, this is actually an orthogonal linear transformation. So in fact, if you just impose one condition that find all isometry which for which this origin is the fixed point, right, then you get just the orthogonal linear transformations. And in dimension 2, you can say something more. So we'll say in the next slide. So the collection of all isometries, in fact, they form a group, and it's called the group of isometries, right? The collection of all isometries under the composition, they form a group, right? If you just compose two isometries, for instance, if you just compose two translation, you get a translation. If you compose two rotation, at least in E2, you get a rotation. So in fact, the composition of any two isometry is an isometry, and with respect to that composition, they form a group, and that group is called group of isometry in En, right? Yeah. So in dimension 2, you can say something more, and if you identify your Euclidean plane with this complex plane, with this complex structure, right? So that you can say this point x, y as x plus i, y, right? And your inner product is written as this, say, z1, z2, the inner product of z1 and z2, two vectors, is this x1, x2 plus y1, y2, right? And the distance between two points is this modulus z1 minus z2. Then it's a good exercise to show that the collection of all isometries of E2, it can be written as the collection of all maps which sends this Z to AZ plus B, where A and B are complex numbers, modulus of A is equal to 1. And the collection of all maps which sends Z to AZ bar plus B, this Z is the complex conjugate of Z, where A, modulus of A is equal to 1, and B is any complex number. Right, so the collection of all isometries in this set A is actually, they are orientation preserving isometries of this E2, and the isometries in this set B, they are called orientation reversing isometries, right? So this is about the Euclidean plane. So is it okay up to this stage? Any problem to anybody? So these are complete classification of isometries of Euclidean plane. In fact, in previous slide I have classified in n-dimensional Euclidean space, but for two-dimensional space, you can say through the complex analysis. Is it okay? Should I go ahead? Yeah. Okay. There is no queries. Yeah. So now I am coming to the upper half plane model of hyperbolic geometry. So here our set is the collection of all complex numbers with imaginary part of that is positive. And our line element is this ds square is equal to mod dz square upon y square. If you write in Cartesian coordinate system, you can also say here this dx square plus dy square upon y square. So here the length of any curve in hyperbolic plane is given by this formula. So instead of just the speed, you have to divide this speed by this part, imaginary part of gamma t, right? Imaginary part of gamma t. And this is because of this line element, because of the form of the line element, because your line element ds square is modulus dz square upon y square, right? So because you are integrating this ds actually. So if you integrate this ds, I mean this mod dz upon y, and so you write the hyperbolic length of the curve gamma in this form, that integral 0 to 1 and this Euclidean speed of gamma divided by the imaginary part of the gamma t, right? So it's a simple exercise just to see the difference between the Euclidean distance and hyperbolic distance. So here is a simple exercise that calculate the hyperbolic length of line segment joining the points I and 2i, right? I and 2i. So maybe at least this exercise I should do in my whiteboard. Suppose this point is your I and this point is your 2i, right? And you take your this gamma t as this I and plus 1 minus t and 2i, right? Maybe it's other way around. You can write this as 2i t times, right? T times I and 1 minus t times 2i. So when you take t is equal to 0, it is 2. So basically, you have to change the orientation. So you should write actually this 2i here and I here, right? So yeah. Right? So this is t times 2i and this is I. It is 0, it is I. So this gamma 0 is equal to I and gamma 1 is equal to 2i, right? What about gamma dot t here? So when you calculate gamma dot t, you get this 2i and minus I. So it's I, right? So what is the length of this curve gamma? This is actually integral of this gamma dot t and divided by this imaginary part of gamma t dt, and t varies from 0 to 1, right? So what is this? This is 0 to 1, and this modulus of gamma dot t is actually 1 divided by, from here you see what is the imaginary part of gamma t. So imaginary part of gamma t is actually equal to this 2it and minus it. So it's it, so it's t simply, right? So 1 upon t and dt. Something is missing. So it's gamma t 2i t 1 minus t.
Sir, 1 plus t.
It's 1 plus, sorry, 1 plus t. Yeah, it's 1 plus t. Yeah, you're right. It's 1 plus t, right? So when you integrate, it will it will become this log 1 plus t, and it's become log 2, right? So as per your usual distance in Euclidean geometry, the distance between this Euclidean distance between this I and 2i, right, is your 1, right? But in fact, this is actually the length of the Euclidean arc length, you can say the Euclidean arc length of this gamma curve is actually 1. But when you calculate the hyperbolic length of this gamma, so maybe instead of saying this distance, we should say this is the Euclidean length of this curve gamma is 1, and the hyperbolic length of this curve gamma, same gamma, is log 2, right? Yeah, another example is here. This is again a very interesting example. So when you find the distance, the length of this line segment joining the two points minus 1 plus I epsilon and 1 plus I epsilon, right? So yeah, if you take say two points here, minus 1 minus I epsilon, and here you say this 1 and plus I epsilon, right? Well, minus 1 plus I epsilon, both of these plus, yeah. So in a similar way, when you calculate the arc length of this line segment, you will get 2 upon epsilon, right? It means as you go this epsilon towards 0, so as epsilon approaches 0, the length of these two points, right, the two points seems to be Euclidean. If you see through Euclidean eye, it seems to be the distance between the two points are 2, right? But when you see through hyperbolic eye, the distance, in fact, the arc length of this line segment joining the two points is going to be infinity, right? So this tending to infinity when this epsilon approaching 0, right? So this is interesting. In this hyperbolic symmetry, you see the difference. Yeah. Someone has any question? Mayrika Dhiman? Do you have any question?
Yeah. How that hyperbolic distance derived, or what is the intuition? Length from
repeat your question, please.
Sir, what is the intuition behind? Sir, what is the intuition behind the length of the two point in our hyperbolic distance? Hyperbolic length.
Yeah. No, I mean yeah. So actually, you see, what for the moment here, I have not defined that from where it comes. I have just defined something, right? I have just defined this line segment, right? This yes, line element, I have just defined that if the line element is this, but actually it has some region also, right? So for the moment, I can only say that because actually that is actually the reason why it is called hyperbolic geometry. So for example, if you see in R3, right, if you take your Euclidean metric, you can pull back your metric on any surface, right? But if you take your metric in R3 as Lorentzian metric, right, and you pull back that metric on the hyperboloid surface, right, then on that surface, the metric is actually going to be hyperbolic metric, right? And they are actually isometric. Whatever models I will show you, these upper half model or the disk model, the two models are actually isometric to that model of hyperbolic surface, right? So that is actually the reason, but directly I'm not going there. I'm just defining that you assume that this is the line element, right? So this is just assumption, and through this assumption, I'm calculating this is the arc length along this line segment, or arc length of the curve, or you can also define the distance so that these two spaces become symmetric spaces, right? So this, for the moment, this is just assumption, but it has some logical meaning also. It has some reasoning also through through the Lorentzian geometry, right? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So now the next question is, what are the geodesics in this hyperbolic space? That is, what are the paths of shortest arc length between two given points, right? I have just defined this line element. Yes, this is the line element that it's just dx square plus dy square upon y square. But with respect to this line element, what are the actually shortest paths? And what are the isometries of this upper half plane model or disk model? So now in this next slide, I'm going to explain about these two questions. So the first question is the shortest hyperbolic path between the two points C plus IA and C plus IB. That is the two points which lie in the same vertical line. C plus IA, and their real parts are same. So therefore the two points lie on same vertical line. So if the two points lie on same vertical line, the line segment joining these two points are the shortest hyperbolic path, right? So just like we saw in the case of I and 2I, so that actually line segment is the shortest hyperbolic path joining I and 2I. And this is actually true for any point, any two point lie on same vertical line. And that distance is actually log B upon A. So the proof is not very difficult here. You can see that if gamma, because both have same real parts, I have taken C here. So suppose gamma T is C plus IYT, where this T varies from 0 to 1, and this YT be any smooth function you can take, right? So this is the parameterization of the line segment joining C plus IA and C plus IB. So for this line segment, if you calculate, you can find the length of that line segment turns out to be log B upon A, right? So the length of the line segment joining C plus IA and C plus IB. So for that, this YT has some precise linear function, you can say. And then you calculate the length of that line segment to be log B upon A, right? But if you take that it's any, this gamma is any, or maybe you take you say as a sigma. So if this sigma is any differentiable curve joining the two points C plus IA and C plus IB, and you want to, for example, you can say possible. So here, so suppose your C plus IA is this point, and C plus IB is this point, and you take any path. It may not be this vertical line segment. It's any path, in fact, maybe this path, right? If you calculate the arc length of this curve sigma, right? So you see the formula. The formula is simply this modulus of gamma dot T divided by imaginary part of sigma. But you know, this sigma dot is actually x dot plus iy dot, and its modulus is square root of x dot square plus y dot square, and it's greater than equal to y dot T, right? Because this is square number, it's greater than y dot T. And for this y dot T, you have just calculated, it turns out to be the length of this line segment. So therefore, the length of this sigma, the arbitrary curve, is actually greater than or equal to the length of the line segment. And therefore, this vertical line segment has the shortest length. So therefore, you have proved actually that the line segment joining the two points which lie in the same vertical line is a geodesic for this upper half plane. Right? Is it okay up to this stage? At least for those for which this is new, I know that for some of you it's really very basic. Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah.
You considered first gamma t as a parameterization of the curve as C plus IYT, and later you considered sigma t another curve joining those two points as xt plus IYT. So
no,
why do you consider YT the same components, imaginary components in both cases?
No, it does not. Actually, in first part here, it is actually, I just told that it is actually a linear function, just like it said, you need actually a linear function so that this gamma 0 is equal to A and gamma 1 is equal to B, right? Just like in previous case, I have considered this, you can take this YT is the convex linear combination of the two points, right? So it's just linear function. This YT is actually a linear function because it's a line segment. You are parameterizing the line segment joining the two points C plus IA and C plus IB. And here it is not. Here you have taken any curve joining the two points, right? So if you want, you can take another, maybe you can write, maybe you can say here is the YT. No, here you can take YT, or here maybe it's Y bar T or maybe Z T, no problem. Yeah.
So okay. Then at the last part,
here this YT is simply just convex linear combination of the this A and B, right? 0 A and 0 B, right? Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
You can write explicitly as a linear function, no problem. Yeah.
So at the last part, when you are defining the length of the curve sigma dot T, then how can you say that it is greater or equal to Y dot T?
No, you see, this is the square number, no?
Yes.
Whatever say this is square, this is going to be positive. So square root of, if you say this is zero, right? Then this is going to be y dot t. So whatever you take here, it must be greater than or equal to y dot t, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. It's okay now. Okay. Thank you.
No. The last implication I did not follow. Then how can you say that the length of h2 with respect to sigma is greater or equal to length of H2 with respect to gamma, comparing gamma T and sigma T?
No, you see here, when your sigma dot here is Y dot T, right? You have just calculated in previous, in this exercise, that when this is Y dot T upon imaginary part of Y dot T, it's going to be length of the line segment, right? In this previous, yes, yeah, it's just length of the line segment. And here, this is going to be the length of this curve sigma, right? So the length of this sigma, therefore, is greater than or equal to length of this line segment for any curve sigma you take, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. You may ask a question that does this proof work for points on same horizontal level? So we have just proved that if you take two points on a vertical level, the line segment joining the two points are actually the shortest path. Line segment joining the two points are shortest path. So you can ask that does the same proof work for point on same horizontal level? So I'm just giving the answer, but you just justify on your own that's actually not. Actually not. So, yeah. So, if you take two points on same horizontal line, this line segment is not going to be the shortest path. Yeah. Now, if you take, I'm just giving a procedure. Now, you know that if two points are in a vertical line, the line segment joining two points is actually a geodesic, is actually the shortest path. Now, I'm giving a procedure that for any two point, they may not lie on same vertical line, how to find the shortest path passing through the two points. So for that, pick any two general points, right? You can send the two points through a map to another two points with same x coordinate, right? But the map should be special. The map should be such that it preserves the arc length, right? So via arc length preserving map, if you send your given points to a pair of points which lie on same vertical line, right? Then by the inverse image, you just send that particular line to a path joining two points, and because the arc length is preserved, the arc length of this new path will be same as the arc length of the vertical line, and because it is minimum, that path will also be minimum. So that's the whole idea. So basically, we want this arc length preserving map. If we know this arc length preserving map, you can find the geodesic through any two point. And so basically, my question is here that we want maps from H2 to H2 such that the length of gamma should be same as the length of FO gamma, right? So gamma is a map, and F is, we call as isometry, right? So F is arc length preserving map, is an isometry of upper half plane. So FO gamma, the length of FO gamma is same as the length of gamma. And this happen if and only if these two equations same. I mean, when these two integrands are same, right? Now you can see that these maps, right? These maps, which are horizontal translations, right? Z goes to Z plus C, or scaling, or this inversion. These map, for these maps, actually, these two quantities are same, right? Either you take horizontal translation, or you just scale, or you invert. So these maps actually preserves the arc length in upper half plane, right? Yeah. Now I'm going to compute the full isometry of this upper half plane. So for that, so from the theory of Mobius transformation, you know that the map from this C hat to C hat given by this Mobius transformation AZ plus B divided by CZ plus D, where AD minus BC not equal to zero, and they are complex numbers, right? So these are actually fractional linear transformation. They are biholomorphic maps. And the restrictions of this map to H2, right? The restriction, these are actually map defined on this C hat to C hat. And if you restrict them to H2 with this condition that A, B, C, D are real numbers and AD minus BC is positive, right? So they are not only biholomorphic on H2, in fact, they are isometries of H2, right? They are not only biholomorphic on H2, they are indeed going to be isometries of H2. Indeed, one can think of the map as an action of this GL2R on H2 as follows. This AZ plus B, this MGZ as AZ plus B upon CZ plus T. When this G acts on this H2, this ABCD, this element of this group acts on this H2, and this action is defined as follows, that this GZ, when G acts on Z, it is given by this AZ plus B divided by CZ plus D. And you can see that this MG can be written as a product of, just you have written in the previous slide, just horizontal translation, scaling, and inversion. And therefore, is an isometry of H2. So therefore, this is actually the full, you can say, orientation preserving isometry of H2. And therefore, now you are interested, what are actually the geodesics passing through two points, right? So we have, you take two points, Z1, Z2 in upper half plane, right? And you know there is a G, there is an element G in this GL2R, such that this MGZ1 and MGZ2, this belongs to a vertical line, right? This is actually a vertical line. Now, the image of this vertical line under this biholomorphic map or Mobius transformation, you know, is either a vertical line or a semicircle centered. So this is actually something we have to show actually. analytically, but this is a proof, is a fact you can prove on your own, that you take any Mobius transformation, it sends a line to a vertical line, either to a vertical line or a semicircle, and precisely you can say about the semicircle that it is centered at this point and it passes through the point A upon C and B upon D, right? So at these two points it intersects your horizontal line. So the shortest path between two points Z1, Z2 is either a vertical line, if they lie on same vertical segment, or a semicircle perpendicular to horizontal line or perpendicular to x-axis, right? So in that way, you can find all geodesics of upper half plane, and these are actually the all isometries, full group of isometries of upper half plane. So these are actually this z goes to az plus b cz plus d, where a, b, c, d are real numbers and a, d minus b, c positive. These are actually orientation preserving isometries, and these are orientation reversing isometries. So this is become the union of these two is actually the full group of isometries of upper half plane. So there are few exercises, if you want, you can solve on your own. So define the distance between two points Z1, Z2 as the length of shortest hyperbolic path, right? So in that way, it becomes a metric space, right? And you can also talk about the hyperbolic circle centered at a point Z0 and radius, say, sigma. So it's defined as the collection of all Z in H2 such that this condition is satisfied. Then it's a very simple but interesting exercise to show that the every hyperbolic circle is same as the Euclidean circle, but with different center and radii, right? So this is very interesting exercise. One should sure at least once solve that this just to feel that if you view from Euclidean eye or hyperbolic eye, pictures of both circles are same, but their centers and radii are completely different. In particular, if you want to see, this circle centered at the point I, the hyperbolic circle centered at I and radius log 2 is same as the Euclidean circle centered at the point 5i upon 2 and radius 3 upon 4. So these two exercises, I think those who are really interested to learn hyperbolic geometry, they should do, must solve. So in a similar way, you can also talk about the second model of hyperbolic geometry, what is called disk model, right? So there, the line segment, instead of just division by the square of imaginary part of Z, you have to divide by this quantity, right? And in fact, you will see that there is a map, what is called Kelly map. Through these two map, these two structures are actually isometric to each other, right? So through this line element, you can find the length of the curve in this disk model through this formula. And through Kelly map, actually the two structures on upper half plane and this disk model, they are actually isometric to each other. And you can also prove that the geodesics in delta, geodesics in disk model are actually the either line segment joining center of the disk or circles which intersect the orthogonally the boundary of the disk. So these are some results. Actually, I'm just stating something, but it requires some proof, and it's not very difficult. If you just do some computation, you can prove, but you must do, because I'm just giving an overview of the whole basic of hyperbolic geometry. So at least I want to motivate that why we study hyperbolic geometry. So these are the full group of isometries for this disk model. So I'm not going in detail. I hope that in coming lectures, you can also see some part of these isometries and their actually subgroups. And there is also this computation of the curvature there, that if the metric is given to you, you can also compute the Gaussian curvature for the corresponding metric as via this formula. For instance, for Euclidean geometry, your this sigma z is 1, and therefore its curvature is equal to 0. For its spherical geometry is going to be plus 1, and for the two models of hyperbolic geometry, its curvature is going to be minus 1. I have stated, because actually I will need to say something in the last part of my talk, and that is why I've just introduced it. I think it's too much for a basic learner, but yeah, just be with us that this is the formula for Gaussian curvature, and through this formula, we can say, at least you remember that the hyperbolic geometry, the curvature of the hyperbolic, the two models of hyperbolic plane is actually constant minus 1. Yeah. Now, yeah, I'm towards the almost finishing today's talk. But before finishing, I'm saying something, some motivational statements. Why we study, why the further investigation is required in hyperbolic geometry. So the two reasons, what I think that it is actually, it's motivate one to study hyperbolic geometry in detail. The first reason is its rich group of isometries. Its isometric group is so rich. You see, in coming slide, you'll soon see that it's so rich comparative to your Euclidean geometry that you can see some beautiful pictures, actually, at least in tessellation of your space or plane. And the second motivation, I think, just I told in my first couple of statement, that most of the surfaces, at least you see in R3, have natural structure of hyperbolic geometry. So you see in Euclidean geometry, you actually tessellate your plane, and you can prove, it's very simple, that only three possibilities are there for tessellation to this regular polygons, right? Lot of polygons you have in your Euclidean geometry, triangle, square, hexagon, quadrilateral, right? Pentagon, n-gon in fact. But you can tessellate only through these three regular gons. One is triangle, the square, and this hexagon. And a simple proof is here. You can go through this simple proof that only three possibilities, because actually the number of sides and the number of polygons meeting at one vertex, if you call n and k, it has to satisfy this equation. And the only integral solutions are actually the 4, 4, 3, 6, and 6, 3 of this equation. And corresponding to this 4, 4, you have a square, 3, 6, you have triangle, and for 6, 3, you have, in hexagon case, 3 hexagons meeting at one vertex, 6 triangles meeting at one vertex, and the 4 squares meeting at one vertex, right? And why it happens here? If you research here, you'll see that this only happened, only the three possibilities are responsible of the fact that the sum of interior angles of triangle in Euclidean geometry is 180, while in hyperbolic geometry you can see the sum of three interior angles of any triangle is very flexible. Well, very flexible. It can be any number between 0 to 180. In fact, for ideal triangles you see the sum of angles is 0, right? And it is always less than 180. So it's flexible, and also it has a richer group of isometry. So you'll see that a lot of tessellation is possible in hyperbolic geometry. Also, few pictures, and it will be in detail in this course. You will find much more, you can see. So you see a lot of possibilities in hyperbolic geometry, and these are tessellation of this disk model, and in a similar way you can also tessellate your upper half plane via different regular bonds and some other pictures also, right? Now for the second motivation, that why we study hyperbolic surfaces, so I just told that most of the surfaces, most of the closed surfaces, you can say, have natural structure of this hyperbolic geometry. So for that little bit, I just introduce a surface and then I will give some statement. So as you know, the surface is basically a two-dimensional manifold, or if you do not know manifold, you just suppose a topological space which is locally homeomorphic to R2. Or as an example, you see these are the surfaces, right? So locally you can just some homeomorphic structure of plane, right? If something, every each of its point has a neighborhood in that that set which is homeomorphic to open set in R2, such a structure is you can call a surface, right? So these are surfaces for us. These are all surfaces, right? And whenever you have a lot of thing in mathematics, you want to classify them, right? So there is a classification also, but up to what, right? Up to what you want to classify, that's a problem. So there is a topological classification here. I'm just stating it, and it's completely classified that you take any closed orientable surface, right? It is homeomorphic to either a sphere or a sphere with one handle, a sphere with two handle, a sphere with n handle for any n in W, n whole number, right? So for instance, you take any closed orientable surface, either it is homeomorphic to a sphere, or it is homeomorphic to torus, or homeomorphic to two torus, etc., etc. And although this is completely different topic, but because I'm actually needed it to explain something, I'm just stating this very interesting result, which actually which connects the two branches of mathematics, what is called topology and geometry. So it says actually, if you integrate the curvature of on a surface, is going to be 2 pi times Euler characteristic of the surface, right? So the left hand side basically, it's related to completely the geometry of the surface, where right hand side is related to the topology of the surface, right? So this Euler characteristic, I think everybody knows about Euler characteristic. So for example, if you calculate Euler characteristic of the closed surfaces, for a sphere, if you calculate a sphere, I think it is homeomorphic to your tetrahedron or cube. If you calculate, it's going to be 2. For torus, it's, if you calculate, it's going to be 0, right? And for any other closed surface, if you calculate, this Euler characteristic is going to be negative, right? So sphere is the only surface, only closed surface for which this Euler characteristic is going to be positive, right? So if you want to put some structure, some geometric structure on the closed surface, such that it has constant curvature, right? Right? So you can only put on a sphere a geometric structure of positive curvature or a metric of positive curvature. So a compact surface of positive curvature, it is homeomorphic to a sphere. There is no other surface, there is no other closed surface than a sphere on which you can put a metric of constant positive curvature. Right? But this is, here is a very interesting result. It says that every compact connected to manifold, it admits a Riemannian metric with constant Gaussian curvature, zero or positive or negative. More precisely, every compact connected two manifold admit a Riemannian metric and a Riemannian covering by the Euclidean plane or a sphere or hyperbolic plane. So what it says, in fact, I just want to make a remark here that in view of the uniformization theorem and Gauss-Bonnet theorem, it is obvious that most of the closed surfaces, just except this sphere and torus, and all those surfaces, because their Euler characteristic is negative, right? You can put a metric structure of constant negative curvature. And that is your hyperbolic structure. So in that way, most of the surfaces in nature, what you see, those closed surfaces have natural structure of hyperbolic geometry. And therefore, I think much more investigation is required on this hyperbolic geometry, hyperbolic structures, etc. So I think maybe I have taken 5 minutes extra. I'm sorry for that. So these are some references. They are basic references. Maybe I will send this Krishnendu notes to all of you. Those who are interested, you must go through that note. It's really very interesting. So thank you all for joining us, and if anybody has any comment or query, it will be my pleasure to discuss.
Hello.
Yeah.
Ha, sir, namaskar.
Namaskar. Ha, sir,
yeah. Very last 10 to 15 minutes, you were talking about two circles, I think, in Euclidean or in hyperbolic geometry.
Yeah. Can you repeat?
You are talking about two circles, that there will be two circles but different centers and radius.
Yeah. So that is actually one circle is actually hyperbolic circle and another is Euclidean circle, right?
I wanted to know is there any map which sends one to another one?
Which sends,
because you are saying that if there is any circle in Euclidean,
I don't think it's very difficult to find. Yeah, you can take any point and a radius, maybe you can calculate. I think it's possible. One is given in the example.
And what about continuity? Is there a continuous map? That's what things,
I have not calculated, but I feel that yes. Yeah, I feel, but yeah, it should, one should calculate it. Yeah, because, in both way, I think, yeah. I don't know exactly, but yeah. Yeah, what you are saying? Yeah.
Identity map is not continuous, right? Or I don't know, actually, I'm just thinking.
It's actually a map from upper half plane cross R plus to upper half plane cross R plus. Is it? Yeah. H2 cross R positive to H2 cross R positive. Yeah. That you are saying?
Yeah, I was just saying H2 to H2, but yeah, okay. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I don't know, actually. So I was just curious because they are very different metrics. So maybe it is not continuous what map you put. I don't know. Krishnendu may know. Krishnendu?
Yeah.
You are there, no?
From where to where you are talking about the map?
H2 to H2. One of them has Euclidean metric, one of them has hyperbolic metric.
Okay. So on H2, first of all, can you give Euclidean metric? I don't think you can give Euclidean metric on H2, no?
Why, the usual distance, right? There is
usual distance, okay.
Yeah.
So they are talking about map from spaces of circles of hyperbolic plane to space of circles in the Euclidean plane.
Yeah, or vice versa. Is there a continuous map?
Yes.
I mean, corresponding to every point and one radius, you can always draw a circle. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there will be a map, definitely, and continue to depend on what sort of topologically, I think you will get a continuous map. Because if you draw, so have you drawn the circle of Euclidean space and the circle in hyperbolic plane? Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what is, have you shown the relation between hyperbolic circles and Euclidean circles?
Have you? What is your question? Have you?
Have you shown the
relation?
No. I have not shown the relation actually.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, actually there is a relation between.
Yeah. So if you have a Euclidean circle.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
On the Arab space.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you can get a hyperbolic circle from there.
Uh-huh.
All right. So there is a relation between the two radius and the center. That probably I can tell you. So, if you take a Euclidean circle, so it will be say north z minus a equal to r, for example, right? If you take a Euclidean circle, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
So corresponding to that, the question is what would be the hyperbolic circle? It is just a matter of computation using the hyperbolic method. That one can probably try to do an exercise. That given a Euclidean circle, what would be the
hyperbolic
circle corresponding to that? Maybe I can tell a few words tomorrow.
Also there may be problem at infinity, right? I just want to know, like, what is there a continuous map from H2 to H2 with two different topology?
H2 to H2 different topology, you are saying?
Yes.
I mean, topologically, I think H2 has the same topology, right? I mean, on the unit disk, you can only give, open box or, usual.
But in hyperbolic geometry, at infinity, you may have trouble, right?
When you are adding the boundary, you are actually extending the hyperbolic plane to the closed disk.
Oh, you're not taking the boundary in H2, really.
Because in the boundary, the hyperbolic metric is infinity. So the hyperbolic metric is not finite on the boundary.
So, but that's what I'm saying. At near boundary, you will have trouble when you take distance, right? It may not remain continuous. I don't know. Certainly not.
It depends on what topology you are giving to measure continuity. What I am saying that I am not thinking in terms of the hyperbolic metric. I am thinking in terms of a circle as a point and a radius. So you take the pair, a point on the hyperbolic plane and a number, positive real number, radius.
But even there, you're getting one from the other, but is that kind of continuous? That's what.
So, if you consider the space of all circles, then I suppose it will be continuous. So, what I remember, I'm correct here. So, suppose you take a point on the upper up space. Z, A plus IB, where Z has radius, say, R. All right. Then the Euclidean circle with the then the Euclidean circle the same circle can be realized as the Euclidean circle, but the radius will be some exponential times r e to the power r times some expression on z. Okay, so this is the exercise that you have a hyperbolic circle of radius r and center z. How you can get a Euclidean circle from there?
Yeah.
But the Euclidean circle is determined by this center on the hyperbolic plane and the hyperbolic radius. Okay, so there will be a
bijective. Suppose it will be continuous, right? Because
it will be continuous. I mean, if you think of it as a point and a real number r, okay, just usual topology on the H2 cross r plus, yeah, then it is a continuous one. It's a 1-1 onto bijection, and that usual topology makes it continuous.
Yeah, but these things increase exponentially. Okay, the radius.
This thing grows exponentially, absolutely. Because as I told you that the diameter of the Euclidean circle will be exponential of,
yeah,
will be some multiple of z and e to the power r, the exponential of the hyperbolic radius.
Yeah. So, what is the reference for basic hyperbolic geometry?
The standard. I mean, you can look at this book by I think for you, I think a good book would be Dalgo. You know.
Can you write in the chat? I can't hear that.
Yeah, yeah. So I can. I think because you are interested in dynamics, right? So from dynamical perspective, I think this Dalgo.
Well, it is. I mean, it doesn't have to be necessarily dynamics, right? I'm also asking for the audience on behalf of the audience.
I see. For audience, I think the best book would be Kato.
Dalgo, okay. Kato, okay. Fuchin groups, okay. So that's elementary or what?
Very elementary.
Okay, so that's nice to hear. And my interest is not only dynamics.
Yeah.
I like other stuff also.
Yeah.
But I think it's a good exercise. So let me find out. Let me write down exercise. Okay. Find out the relation between the Euclidean circle.
So maybe other participants also, if anybody has any query or comment.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a very basic question, sir.
Yeah, please.
You have told us about the upper half plane and the disk model.
Yeah.
And you wrote the metric about them.
Yeah.
So what is the intuition between those metrics? Like, I want to say, we know the Riemannian metric is defined by ds square equals to gij dxi dxj, where gij is the components of the matrix tensors.
Yeah.
In Euclidean geometry, those gijs are defined by conical delta.
Yeah.
So how do you define the matrix in the upper half plane? Like dz mod of dz square by y square. So where it is coming from?
Yeah.
Or in the disk model, you have defined dz square by 1 minus 4z the square mod.
So, yeah. Okay. So I just answered also your question previously that it's actually isometric to the hyperbolic model. If you take your Lorentzian space, right? In R3, if you take your Lorentzian matrix, right? Dx square plus dy square minus dz square. And you take a hyperboloid of one portion of hyperboloid of two sheet, right? And you take the pullback matrix of that Lorentzian matrix and on the upper half, this hyperbolic sheet, this hyperboloid of one, two sheet, right? Right? So you get a metric there, and that metric is actually isometric to this Poincaré disk metric, and the same metric is isometric to your upper half plane. In fact, this upper half plane model and this Poincaré disk model, these two are isometric via the Scaly map. For instance, suppose you have your map in upper half plane, you have your metric in upper half plane, and you have a Kelly transformation which is a biholomorphic transformation from upper half plane to unit disk. Okay.
Okay, sir.
And you just pull back that metric in upper half plane to this disk model, and you get exactly this Poincare metric.
Okay, sir.
So it's actually a pullback metric from, and in a similar way, you can also basically these three models are isometric to each other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So.
Yeah. So I have given a. Exercise.
Yeah.
The Euclidean circle and hyperbolic circle. So there is a definitely a bidirectional between the Euclidean circle and hyperbolic circle. And if you just consider your space of circles as a space, which is H2 cross R, then this is actually continuous. Both sides. Of this fact.
Maybe one can calculate it. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, it's a, I think it just follow from the hyperbolic metric.
But, yeah, yeah.
But if you have a continuous map, then I mean you can as well study Euclidean geometry, right? Why do you want to study hyperbolic?
Yeah, because the hyperbolic circles as round circles, but with a different center and with a different radius.
I know, but I mean, you can, if you have one-one correspondence, why don't we just study Euclidean geometry and this transit?
Oh, yeah. You know, I mean, the thing is that, that if you consider geometric shapes, then there is not much difference between hyperbolic geometry and Euclidean geometry when you consider circles. But if you look at triangle, I mean, those are different, right? So that's why.
They are thin.
Triangles are thin in hyperbolic.
Yeah. So, okay. Technical questions are over. I want to ask a non-technical question.
Yeah.
We want to stop recording. So, what is the aim of this 1 year in advance pre-SIMPA? You're going to test our memory or what? I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, it's actually maybe we'll organize, we will plan several series, such series, and we hope that most of the participants will continue in that series, because you see in last year also we have, we